Welcome to Public Health On Call, a podcast from the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health, where we bring evidence, experience, and perspective to make sense of today's leading health challenges. If you have questions or ideas for us, please send an email to publichealthquestion@jhu.edu. That's publichealthquestion@jhu.edu for future podcast episodes.
This is Lindsay Smith-Rogers. Today, measles. What happened to this highly contagious infectious disease during the pandemic, and what's happening now? Professor William Moss, Executive Director of the Johns Hopkins International Vaccine Access Center, speaks to Dr. Josh Sharfstein about how the measles virus is poised to have a banner year to the detriment of people everywhere. Let's listen.
Dr. Bill Moss, it's great to see you. Thanks for joining the podcast to talk about measles, a different infectious disease than some of the ones we've been spending a lot of time on, but pretty important one.
Yes, and thanks, Josh, for having me. And I'm glad we have this opportunity to talk about measles. 2019, I think, was the year of measles globally and here in the United States, and obviously superseded by the COVID-19 pandemic. But it's an important disease that still persists with us.
Let's just remind everyone about what measles is. What happens to someone who gets measles?
Yeah, so measles is caused by measles virus, and it's an infectious disease that's largely characterized by fever and rash. So children, or really anyone who gets measles, will develop a fever and this very characteristic blotchy red rash. It starts on the head and extends over the entire body. And that's how many people diagnose measles. But what measles can do in some situations is cause a number of different kinds of complications. And measles can actually cause death, largely by pneumonia, either due to secondary bacterial infections or measles virus itself, through diarrhea. There are a number of neurologic complications of measles that can be very, very serious, although they're rarer than pneumonia and diarrhea, and a number of other different complications. Measles, for example, used to be one of the most common causes of blindness in the world.
I know one of these neurologic complications can happen years afterwards.
Yes, you're right. So there are really three neurologic complications. There's one that occurs very early on that's really an autoimmune phenomenon. It has the complex name acute demyelinating encephalomyelitis. There's another type of neurologic complication that occurs in immunocompromised patients where measles virus actually replicates in the brain. But the one that occurs 8 to 10 years after measles case is called subacute sclerosing panencephalitis. It's a really progressive neurologic deterioration ending in death. Now, it's quite rare, but it can occur in one of the most serious consequences of measles.
So when you say 2019 was the year of measles, that's because there were a lot of cases and I suppose a lot of complications.
Yes. Maybe I'll start, Josh, by just taking a longer historical perspective, because it's important for people to realize that prior to the introduction of measles vaccine, it was first licensed here in the United States in 1963, there were an estimated 2 to 4 million deaths per year globally due to measles. It was one of the major causes of child mortality. Since then, we've seen remarkable progress in the reduction in measles cases and measles deaths as a consequence of the scale up of measles vaccines. So since around 2000, from 2000 to now, it is estimated that measles vaccines have averted close to 60 million deaths. So enormous progress in reducing the burden of disease due to measles. With that historical perspective, in 2019, we saw a global increase in the number of measles cases in all regions of the world. There were particularly large outbreaks in the African continent. But even here in the United States, there were 1,274 measles cases reported here in the United States, which was the largest number since the last bigger outbreak that we've had here in the United States from about 1989 to 1991. So it was really an increase in the number of cases. Those were associated, obviously, with deaths. Globally, the number of measles deaths in 2019 was about 200,000.
200,000 is not a small number of deaths. That's really impressive and begs the question of why. Why measles came surging back if there is such a safe and effective vaccine? Is it because the vaccine stopped working?
No, and that's a really important question. And one of the important things about measles virus is that it's just very highly contagious, much more contagious, for example, than SARS-CoV-2 that causes COVID, much more contagious than influenza virus. In fact, it's one of the most contagious viruses or pathogens that we know. And because of that, it requires very high levels what we call population immunity, in order to really decrease the number of cases. And so that requires very high levels of coverage with measles vaccines. And around the world, most countries and the World Health Organization recommends 2 doses of a measles-containing vaccine. Here in the United States, that's measles, mumps, rubella, plus often varicella vaccine. In much of the world, it's just a combination of measles and rubella vaccine. But it's this kind of buildup of susceptible individuals in populations as a consequence of not achieving those very high levels of immunization coverage that allows for these large outbreaks.
So it's not that the vaccine isn't working, it's just that not enough people are being vaccinated.
Exactly. It's not a problem with the vaccine. It's a very highly effective and safe vaccine that we've had for decades. It's just not getting that high enough number of people vaccinated.
So let's turn to the pandemic. A lot of people can get to the doctor. I know that a lot of vaccination rates fell around the world. What did you see for measles?
Yes, measles is really interesting. So we saw 2 things happening. One is, as you mentioned, disruptions to both routine immunization services that are providing measles vaccines around the world. But in the measles world, we also use what we call supplemental immunization activities. They're really, you can think of them as mass vaccination campaigns that are used in many countries, not here in the United States, but many countries around the world, to try to make sure that enough children are vaccinated. There were disruptions to routine immunization services, as you mentioned, that could be during the pandemic, that could be due to disruptions in supply chains of vaccines, that could be due to healthcare workers not staffing the clinics, but also parents not being able to bring their children to a health center or a pediatrician here in the United States to get vaccinated. There were also disruptions or delays to these mass vaccination campaigns around the world. All of that resulted in a lot of unvaccinated children and a decrease in measles vaccine coverage globally. So measles vaccine coverage around the world with the first dose has hovered around 85%. It dropped to 83% in 2020 and 81% in 2021. That's the lowest measles vaccine coverage that we've had globally since 2008. That may sound like a small percent decrease, but it actually translates into a large number of children globally. And so now it's estimated that about 25 million children have missed out on measles vaccine globally. That number increased from 2019 to 2021 by almost 6 million.
So that creates a lot more kids who could get measles.
Exactly. That's what's happening. There's just a large increase in the number of children susceptible to measles globally.
And are you seeing that increase in measles cases?
Yes. So this is what's interesting. After the pandemic, the number of, at the global level and here in the United States, of reported measles cases dropped dramatically to historically low levels. They started coming up a little bit after May 2020. We saw this dramatic decrease in the number of reported measles cases. Started coming up a little bit in 2021, a little bit more in 2022. There are a number of potential explanations for this. One is that there were just fewer susceptibles after the large increase in cases in 2019. Second, we know that surveillance systems were impacted by the pandemic. And so some of it could be just poor reporting and poor surveillance systems or disrupted surveillance systems. I think the most important thing actually were a number of the measures put in place to mitigate the spread of SARS-CoV-2, the lockdowns, the masking, the staying at home, all the reduced travel, all of that impacts measles virus transmission because it too is transmitted through the respiratory route like SARS-CoV-2.
So I think what you're telling me is vaccine coverage went down. We know that when vaccine coverage goes down, measles cases go up. But during the pandemic, measles cases did not go up. They went down. And so you're a measles expert. You're scratching your head. You're saying, why did this happen? And sounds like you think perhaps the control measures for COVID helped with measles. Perhaps there were more cases that just didn't get reported because the people were all working on COVID. If those theories are right, and there are a lot more kids that are susceptible, then we should see a pretty big surge in measles as we really emerge from the pandemic. Would you say that's fair?
Exactly. And that's precisely my fear and my concern and the concern of many in global public health, that as we know there's measles virus circulating around the world, right now we're seeing large numbers of cases in India, for example, Ethiopia, Indonesia. It's where the fire's burning right now are in many countries in the African and Asian region that have poor healthcare systems where there's been this big buildup of susceptible children. But it's the fire's going to spread, and we're going to start seeing, this is my fear, because of this increased number of children susceptible to measles, because of the declining vaccination rates, that we have a setting where we could see the forest fire spread around the world. And so we could be right at the beginning of large measles outbreaks.
Now, I heard you mention India and Indonesia. Did you mention those because that's where you fear to see more cases or because that's where the cases are? In other words, is this nightmare becoming a reality?
Yes, I would say this nightmare is becoming a reality. Those are where the cases are this over the past 4 to 6 months, a number of countries in Africa, a number of countries in Asia. And it's not surprising that that's where this anticipated resurgence of measles is starting. But again, now that people are traveling, we're going to see this virus spread.
What can be done to blunt the potential wave of measles cases and serious illnesses and deaths?
So the bottom line is to catch up our vaccination. And the last week of April, April 24th to April 30th, is World Immunization Week. The theme this year is the big catch up. And it's exactly this, Josh. It's about catching up on vaccinations. Measles is, I think, one of the most important, but not the only one. All those children who missed measles vaccination during the pandemic. And it's really getting the immunization systems to recover from the setbacks and disruptions from the pandemic and really get back on track to meet our country, regional, and global goals that have been set. So theme this year for World Immunization Week is the big catch-up, and that's what we really need to do to prevent a large-scale global outbreak of measles.
Last question. Is the world mobilizing like it should?
The world is fatigued with vaccination because of the pandemic. So I would say we're not there yet. We need to mobilize. And I recognize that we've just been through 3 difficult years with this pandemic and struggling with maintaining high vaccination rates for COVID-19. We're going to really need to prevent the resurgence of other vaccine-preventable diseases, or else we're going to be seeing outbreaks. And measles is the one that's going to come first.
Well, a lot's at stake, a lot's at stake for children who also lost a lot during the pandemic. Dr. Moss, thank you so much for explaining this all to us. Thanks for your work, not only during Immunization Week, but every other week of the year.
Thank you very much, Josh.
Public Health On Call is a podcast from the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health, produced by Joshua Sharfstein, Lindsay Smith-Rogers, and Stephanie Desmond. Audio production by J.B. Arbogast, Holly Cardinale, Philip Porter, Spencer Greer, and Matthew Martin, with support from Chip Hickey. Distribution by Nick Moran. production support from Catherine Ricardo. Social media run by Grace Fernandez and Shian Briscoe. If you have questions or ideas for us, please send an email to publichealthquestion@jhu.edu. That's publichealthquestion@jhu.edu for future podcast episodes. Thank you for listening.